Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the creation of my real self presentation, Jesus examines the choice God made to create our soul, which is our real self. What our condition was at the time of creation and incarnation, what God's creation of ourselves tells us and summarizes our current undeveloped state. Recorded on the 10th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
I just have a note before we begin. Please be more concerned about your microphones, guys. We're losing a lot of your sound when you answer, so you just need to hold it more up on an angle towards your mouth that you're speaking to, and make sure that you can hold it close enough, because it's very hard sometimes at the back to hear, and when it's very hard up the back to hear, it's also very low sound for our recording as well. So if you can just be mindful of that with our microphones. Okay. So we come to the creation of my real self, and as Mary stated this morning, this session is about becoming my loving self. So the next 2 days we're looking at how to become my loving self. So to know what my loving self is, I've got to sort of understand a bit about my real self and how God created it. So this is the point of this particular discussion. The only problem with this discussion is that I could spend 30 hours on it and still not even scratch the surface of it, right? And so 1 hour on it is, what's that going to do for me? Hardly anything at all, unfortunately. So I'm sure that at some point we're going to have to give you far more detail. But a part of the wonderful thing about the way God's created you is that you're going to be discovering your real self for the rest of your existence. So this is a very, very important thing to remember. That we can give you a brief summary of some of the things you will discover, but at the end of the day, it is a discovery process and a personal process that you're going to need to go through for yourselves. Okay, so the creation of my real self. Number one thing to remember, I am the pinnacle of God's creation. So we want to see, the point of this section is really this, like, what has God done to create my real self? And I am the pinnacle of God's creation. And most of you, I've said that many times before, right, to you. Most of you don't know what that means yet at all. Let me give you some examples of what it means. Your soul, is more complex than the universe itself. And the only things that are almost just as complicated as your soul is the laws that govern it. Right? So the laws that govern it are a complex set of laws that eventually you'll discover as through your own engagement of the process of engaging and coming to know your real self, you'll eventually discover these things about yourself. That you are the most complicated being in the universe, and that applies to us collectively and individually. Interesting thought, hey? That we actually are more complex than the universe itself. And in some ways you can see it if you examine the human body as a sort of a sort of type or a what would you call it? There's a word for that, isn't there? But I can't remember it for the moment. This English language thing is getting me a bit. But it's like your physical body is like an example of the complexity of your soul in some ways, because your physical body is one of the most complex organisms physically, right? And in fact, of all the organisms that humankind examine, the human organism, the actual physical body, is still the least understood compared to the rest of the organisms that we examine. And you can see then, if our human body is the least understood, then what about the spirit body? That must also be the least understood organism in the spirit world, right? And the reality is our soul, which governs those two bodies, is even more complicated again and complex again. So let's look at some basics about its complexity. And that's all we're really going to be able to do at this stage, right? But it's important for you to understand that as the pinnacle of God's creation, you are the most complex thing in the universe. And there's a whole set of complex laws that you can understand once you connect to your soul that govern the development and continuation and the very survival of the human soul. And not only its development and survival, but also its transformation. The human soul is the only organism that God has created that can be transformed from its current created condition into a divine condition. And there's a whole set of laws that govern the transformation of the human soul from the physical condition it's created in its first instance and the transformation into the divine condition. And even involved in the potentiality of that occurring is an incredible potentiality that's been offered. So a very, very complicated and complex organism, the human soul. So let's examine our human soul, the soul itself. I've drawn these things before. So here we are, we've got our soul, and perhaps the way I could draw it is like this in the beginning, but the trouble is you can't see that, so I'll have to just expand that up to this. So remembering that when it's first created, it's at its most tiniest of states. And its growth is dependent upon a number of things. So just like a baby when it's first created is just, it begins in the cell. As soon as the two cells merge in that split cell state, that's its smallest time, right? But it still exists. And it's a similar thing with the human soul, that the human soul is created in a similar way and then expansion can occur. But let's say it's this large, right? And it has characteristics and qualities, but basically it has two halves. We've talked about the split of the two halves in a sense, but the reality is the two halves actually don't split. I've talked about it with you as splitting because you need to grasp it in terms of what's happening in the incarnation process. But the reality is, from God's perspective, the two halves are still together. They're not in a unified state yet, but they are together. They are joined together energetically. So you can think of it as joined together as an energy joining them together. Now remember this soul also, we draw it like this, only because for many of you, you came from a background of New Age philosophy and so forth, and you recognize that symbol as sort of like a yin-yang, sort of something related to the soul. But the reality is, of course, it doesn't look like that. You know? And I think most of you are probably aware that it doesn't. And in fact, it's not even a three-dimensional form. Its dimensional states change into different dimensional states. And so it, as it grows, its complexity also grows and what it looks like grows. And the reality is you won't see these souls until you are in the soul union state yourself. Now, the soul union state is defined as this state where both halves are in a completely aware state with each other and an aware state in their relationship with God, and they've gone through a whole series of processes, received God's love in order to become unified. And in fact, it's impossible for the soul union state to occur without receiving God's love. But the soul energetically is still joined together. So here we are in this state, we're joined with the other half. And then we have to become somehow, and in this state, of course, we're unaware, we don't know who we are yet or any of those things. And a process has to be engaged in order for us to become aware. When we become to the process that God designed to become aware is the process called incarnation. And basically the process of incarnation is that two bodies are created by the commingling of the parental cells through the sexual act. The two bodies are created at that point in time. Both bodies also in a undeveloped state. Just a double cell initially, and then they replicate. There's a genetic structure in those cells that determine how everything replicates and how everything grows. And you can imagine then, can't you, that their soul itself must have some kind of similar thing where it has a genetic structure that means that as it grows, it can replicate and change, but the structure is built inside of the soul itself. So the laws, this is the incredible thing about what God's created, is the laws themselves, there's external laws, and then there's laws that are written in the actual genetic structure. So in the genetic structure of the body, the cell structure contains the DNA, which basically are the laws that govern its replication, right? The same applies to the spirit body. And you would have to assume then, wouldn't you not, that it's probably very similar for the soul, that as it grows and changes and as it receives divine love, how it changes depends upon some laws that are built inside of the soul itself as a part of its structure, but also that are affected by outside events and circumstances, outside laws. So here we have our soul, most complicated creation, and of course then once it incarnates, it needs these two bodies, and I'll draw it as a male-female split in this case, just like so. So it needs these two bodies in order for the half of the soul that's unaware of the other half to learn. So spirit body is required, physical body is required. These bodies are both created at the time of conception. And from the moment of conception, the soul can be said to have incarnated and individualized. From that moment on, even though it's still in a state where its awareness is right, the moment before that state, it had no awareness at all of itself. It had instinctual things that are built into the soul itself that requires certain things to activate. And once those particular things occur, those events activate the soul and also its ability to connect to the bodies and so forth, and away that process goes. Right, so the incarnation process requires this process to occur before individualization is complete. So you could say that the individualization process begins at the time of the first half of the soul being conceived, and the individualization process ends at the time the second half of the soul is conceived. Right. Now it's individualized. The job of individualization is complete. The soul, of course, in that state is still very, very undeveloped. So it's like I said, a little tiny cell. It's just in the process of starting its own development. Right? But connected to these bodies, which are also at the conception phase, just a little tiny cell. And then slowly awareness begins, develops. Yeah? Okay. So there's our soul. Now, some things that we need to be aware of. There is energetic connection between the two halves of the soul. You are not this, you can't say that this person is I. That's not true. This is I. Right? All the laws that apply to the soul apply to the whole soul, not just to its half. So the I is you and the other half of you. That's I. Most of you don't believe that at this stage, and in fact, you're completely unaware of that. And so what that does, your lack of awareness does, is it does this to you. It creates barriers internally between the two halves of the soul, which is why I've been drawing them like this. right? The lack of awareness, and we're talking now about soul-based emotional awareness, so it makes no difference what I tell you intellectually at all, right? What happens is there's got to be something that changes emotionally before this awareness process begins, the reconnection, if you like. But the reality is, from God's perspective, you're already connected to the other half. You're just unaware of it. And in fact, for many of you, you want to be unaware of it. In fact, for many of you, you'll want to be and continue unaware of it for hundreds of years, if not thousands of years. Just depends on your will and how you exercise your will to be unaware. So what you've done is you've created an I and another I and called them separate persons, separate beings. That's what you've done. Now, you imagine if our parents hadn't had this separation between the genders or this desire to just be I based upon no connection with the other half. Well, it's very likely then as children that we'd grow up believing there is our other half somewhere as a part of us that we become aware of quite rapidly, which is what happened for myself in the first century, actually. I was aware that there was the other half of myself from a very, very young age because I didn't have the injury at the time of the lack of awareness. The emotional barriers that caused me to not be aware did not exist. Does that make sense? And it wasn't because of me, it was because God chose to remove them, because if God didn't choose to remove them, nobody in the end would have learnt it. So he had to do something to make it change so we could become aware. So there's the I. The I is not you, not I. Is it all getting complicated already? The I is two of you, one as one. That's I. Yeah. You can see that any feelings of self-determination regarding the I just being me, you know, AJ rather than myself and Mary, Jesus rather than Mary and Jesus, any self-determination has to be caused by emotional injury. And it is caused by emotional injury and a lack of awareness, so lack of personal awareness. So Amber, you'd like to ask?
Just with the physicality of the soul, is it an energetic orb? Because I wasn't sure if it looked like a teardrop shape, like an upside. So is it like an energetic orb?
You want me to tell you what the soul looks like I'd have to describe, well, the soul changes what it looks like depending on what dimension you've entered. So assuming we're talking about a 36-dimensional soul already connected in a union state, I would have to somehow be able to describe to you what that looks like in a three-dimensional way. Now, that's impossible. It's impossible for me to do so. So it's, you cannot and you will not see 36 dimensions in a three-dimensional state. And there's no way I can represent it. All I can do is maybe later on I will describe it mathematically, right? Okay. But it's mathematics that at this stage probably no one on earth will understand.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? But I will describe it mathematically. But that's probably the only way you can, because mathematics happens to be the universal language, if you like, of love.
Yep.
In a lot of ways. And it is the universal language of love. This is why most of you are very opposed to mathematics, because actually there's a huge connection with love and mathematics. And that's why most of us become opposed to mathematics, because as we shut down with love, we also shut down towards mathematical certainty.
Yeah. And also you said that we pretty much like to be in denial of who our other half is.
Yeah.
Would a huge majority of that be because we really are at war with ourselves and we don't like who we are, so we're just automatically going to go, yuck, like I don't even want you in my life because you look like me?
Exactly. Partly it's this terror that we have of being our real selves.
Okay.
Yeah, yep. Which is a part of this global terror that we actually have. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good day. So Laura, if you're just straight.
How come when you had a few sins removed from you in your first century, it didn't have it wasn't the I soul, it wasn't the full soul, so Mary still had...
It's always the full soul, it's just that Mary did not have the awareness. And she couldn't have unless that was removed from her.
So that's what I'm saying. If it only got removed from, because there's no halves.
Well, it's only removed through the process of awareness. And this is something you'll discover. The process of one half becoming aware automatically connects it and makes it realize there is a connection with the other half. But that doesn't mean the other half knows the connection exists or is aware.
So they still have to go through
it. Still has to go through the process of firstly becoming aware of itself as a half and then becoming aware of itself as a whole. Does that make sense? That's a part of the growth process. And in fact, when you enter the at-one-ment state with God, you are now relatively aware of yourself as a half. And from that point on, so from the eighth sphere to the 36th sphere, you're working on developing awareness of the other half. Does that make sense? So it's quite a complex process, right? It took me in the first century to become aware of myself. I was 31 years of age. Then it took me to become aware of my other half and my other half to become aware of me. It took us 1900 years to do that. So that gives you some idea of the complexity of the process of the union state. Does it not? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. If it took somebody who's pretty dedicated finding out God's truth 1900 years, then that tells you that it must be a pretty complex process. Does it not? Yeah, so whenever we've talked about it in the past, you've not given these things any consideration, but you can see that it must be a pretty complicated process of awareness. So maybe if we come to Fab first and then... And to be honest with you, we're now getting stuck down in the details and this is what happened with the first group. I didn't get past this this first part. So anyway, we'll ask a few questions and we have to move on.
I was just going to say that you paved the way to make it easier for other souls to become a union state quicker than 1900 years, though, didn't you? Because you led a way of teaching with God. And
yeah, the reality is that other souls have reached the union state faster, but not much faster.
Yeah, okay.
Because there's so many lessons to learn in that place. So, you know, the reality is Corny took 50 or so, 60 years less. And my son and daughter took about 70 years less or so. Yeah. So but the majority of them have taken like over, I don't know anybody at this stage who hasn't taken over like 1800 years.
Yeah, so it just describes the complexity of that soul.
Yeah. Yeah. And Alex.
In the sexuality talk that you spoke about, that you gave in Greece, I feel like you talked a lot about soulmates and soulmate interaction and the feelings you can encounter. You said something, you said it's only in the fifth sphere of the spirit world that spirits begin to gain an awareness of the other half of themselves.
Yeah, the main reason why, Alex, is because from a soul awareness, I'm talking not just an intellectual awareness, because all of you have been told that this is the way it is. That's completely different than having a soul awareness. For a soul awareness to develop, you have to reach a certain condition of love. And for the majority of people on the planet, there's a lot of issues between the genders, between the two halves, which mean that they've got to work through those conditions of love before they'll reach an awareness. Now, most of you have been avoiding those issues, right? So, you know, and in fact, purposefully, many of you purposefully, even I hear you say even, I'll work on myself first. So who are you talking about now? It's because I is both of you, not half of you. So when you say, I'm going to work on myself first and then I'll know, you're really basically proving right from the beginning that you don't understand the soul really yet. You know, you don't see that it's going to require that you work on all of the blockages to the other half and the other half works on all the blockages to you. And your own half's awareness will, by the time you get to the fifth sphere, generally you become quite aware. But it still doesn't mean that you know everything, because you'd hardly know anything at that stage. It's just a, it's just that you're now aware of all the things that stop you from getting together with your soulmate. You think of this, a person in the sixth dimension, which is perfected natural love, still is 30 dimensions away from a soul union. You follow? And the person in the sixth dimension often believes they know their soul, who their soulmate is, and they have a soulmate relationship, but they don't. Because a soulmate relationship can only really be developed with the reception of God's love. Right? Most people in the sixth sphere of the spirit world don't believe that. So they don't, they remain separate. They join together, they're physically together frequently, most of the time, in fact, but they still are not together at the soul level. There's a big difference between being together at the soul level and your development physically. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Just in that talk, you also said that it's something, it's a process that can be begun on Earth, and that, and
of course,
that people don't.
Remember, you can be in the fifth sphere on Earth. You can be in the 30th. You can be in the 36th sphere on Earth. Right. So you can develop these things on Earth. But it's going to take both halves doing it. So the likelihood of it happening on Earth is much more remote than the likelihood of you becoming at one with God while on Earth as a half. Does that make sense?
Do you mean the soul union state is much more remote?
Yeah, well, it's much more... it's 30 or 29 dimensions removed. The at-one-ment state is 28 dimensions removed from the soul union state. So you can see that, obviously, and the soul union state requires two people firstly becoming at one with God, and then both being motivated enough to actually develop the state of union with each other. So that requires a really strong use of both halves' will, if you like. Does that make sense? And the majority of people on Earth don't engage their will hardly at all, let alone have that intense amount of will to continue that development. It is possible that some of you may reach this union state while on Earth. Unlikely, because it's going to require the other half of you in the one state. But bearing in mind that once two of you are at one with God, you now can live forever on Earth if you wanted to, so then you'd have time to work through the other dimensional existences. Does that make sense? If you're one with God, you can't decay. Your body doesn't decay. It completely replicates itself, usually less than every 7 years. And as a result of that, you sustain, you know, 20 to 25-year-old looking body and spirit body, and you can potentially live forever barring somebody harming you. And under those circumstances, many of you on Earth could reach the union state. Does that make sense? The likelihood of it happening is more remote than the likelihood of you as one half reaching the union state, because the likelihood of the other requires two halves reaching a state that is 30 dimensions removed from the union, the one-ment with God state. Does that make sense?
Yeah. But you can become aware of the other half of yourself while on Earth, even in the,
oh,
in
you
the
can be
beginning processes.
Well, I've just said you can even become at one with them in a union state. So the whole thing's possible. It just depends on will, use of will.
So even at this point, with my current degree of soul condition,
yep.
If I have a desire for my soulmate,
yep.
If I want to develop
myself. But you don't
myself,
have a desire for your soulmate.
No, yeah, I realise there's a lot of blocks.
Yeah, you know, many of you think you have a desire when really you're just living in addiction, and that's not desire. That's I want this from them, I want that, I want this, I want that in a relationship. Many of you feel that, you know, a need for your other half, that's not what it's like either, and so forth. You're going to have to deconstruct all of this. Before, this is why, and deconstructing all of this requires growth in love. And this is why by the time you get to the stage where you're really starting to accept your soulmate, many of you will be in the fourth or fifth sphere, but still here on Earth. But you'll be in that location, in that space, if you like, that condition of love. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I completely agree with that.
Yeah. Alex, I don't want to answer any more here because we need to move on. You know, it's like we're getting bogged down in a lot of personal questions here rather than covering important details. Is there any important details that you need to ask about this before I move on? Now, just one thing I'd like to say, and this is all I'm going to say about it, but there's a lot more we could say. These things are not you. And the reality is, all of you believe they are you. And in fact, from all of you at this stage, you all believe the physical body is you. And you identify with it. You identify with the face you have. You identify with the, you know, your experience, your personality. What you call your personality often is just this anyway. So you don't even know what that is yet, most of you. But you identify with your physical body so intensely that it makes it very, very difficult for you to even realize that you've got a spirit one from an emotional perspective. But you measure many spirits identify so emotionally with their spirit body that it makes it very, very difficult for them to understand that, no, there's this other creature, which they actually are a half of, that the spirit body is just needing to be connected to while it's growing to the point where the union place is possible. It needs the bodies, and remember, the bodies are connected through cords. So we've got a silver cord connecting the physical body with the spirit body. We've got you could call it a gold cord if you like, connecting the spirit body with the soul. Each stage of the organism, and these two stages are physically created, this stage God created, these, and that applies to everyone bar the first human couple on any planet, these stages are basically, they're just interconnections to allow the wiring, if you like, to allow experiences from the physical body would be transferred to the spirit and transferred to the soul. And when the physical body disappears, this wiring here allows spirit body interactions to be transferred to the soul, so you can absorb things. And the soul, in fact, controls these bodies. So these bodies are completely under the control of the soul. And in fact, if a person conceived and no soul ever got connected to that particular conception, that conception would die. You'd end up with death of the body, of those two bodies, as a result, because it actually needs the soul to survive. The law, God's law, one of God's laws dictates the fact that the survival of the human form physically is dependent upon its connection with the soul. Make sense? There's a lot more that can be said, right? Yeah. Scratch the surface of that. I think we've just sort of like touched it, maybe, or maybe just brushed it just a touch. Yeah. Now, what I would like to do is encourage you to think about the questions that you have and write them down and send them in to us. Because then what we can do is answer those questions in more detail and give you more of a concept of what's going on. If you look at the outline, you'll already see there's many things that I haven't covered just in that first section. I'm meant to be in my created condition like 15 minutes ago. And so in that first section, the first half of the page, I've already not said a lot of things that need to be said there, let alone before we move on to my created condition. But we need to move on because we need to understand some basic things about how we've been created with regard to the created condition. Right. So if you look at the created condition section, you'll see that at the time of incarnation, the soul is in a certain condition. The condition is that it is unaware of itself at the moment of incarnation, shortly after it begins the development of awareness, but at the moment of incarnation, it is unaware of itself. It also has not sinned. Just before it incarnates, it has not sinned. Right? And it doesn't even have a desire to sin. It also doesn't have a desire to not sin. It doesn't have any desires at all that it recognizes because it's unaware. It's only once it incarnates that it begins the process of developing awareness and therefore can begin either developing the desire to sin or the desire to avoid sin. Now, for the majority of us, as we've seen in the creation of our pain, we've got our parent sin now, that the soul is the poor child's now accepting whatever sins now of the bodies that, and the souls of the people around it, because it has no ability to determine what is a sin and what is not at this stage. This is the damage we do to our children, because we're unaware of sin. We're unaware. We haven't let it go. We haven't processed this. Because we've chosen to create that and not process that, not let it go, our child then has no choice but to accept some of it, right? And this is a terribly unloving thing we do to our child. But all of us have done it who have had children without awareness. And in our lack of awareness of what's been created, our child now starts absorbing the sins that we've created. And that's why in the Paget messages it refers to the sins of the father, multi-generational sins being passed from one generation to the next. Now, God made it that way purposefully, because it also has benefits in the opposite direction. It's like everything God has done, if you misabuse it or abuse it, it can turn out to be terrible. If you use it and actually support it, it can turn out to be wonderful. And one of the wonderful benefits of a parent, both parents removing sin, is if a child is then conceived without sin, it has none of this to deconstruct. Imagine what a wonderful benefit that is. And then on top of that, it would be born, if the parents were aware, they were soulmates themselves and were aware of the soulmates from an emotional perspective, it would be born with an awareness of the other half of itself at the time of birth, which would develop to a conscious awareness as the brain develops. And so by the time they're 5, 6 or 7 years of age, they would have met their soulmate, recognized them and identified them and know them. So that's the benefits of having it this way. But you see, mankind, we put our muddy foot into it all, don't we? And we turn it all into something that looks pretty bad because of the use of our will in an unloving way. But the reality is, if we used our will lovingly as parents and we released this construction, this sin-based construction, our children would have a fantastic start in life. And in fact, by the time they were 7, the majority of people on earth would think they're sort of some different kind of race than what we're completely used to on this planet. So that's our potential. So at the time of incarnation, God has allowed us to basically be in a blank state, which is fantastic, actually, because it allows us to learn positively or negatively. It depends on choices made, though, of course. Right. And the blank state means that there's no divine spark in me. There's no automatic knowledge of everything. There's no understanding of everything. Right? I'm not pure love. I am love in a natural love state, but not pure from God's perspective. I haven't received God's love. I'm not at one with God at the time of conception. I'm not even aware that there is a God at the time of conception. All this awareness has developed over time. God created it that way. And can you see that God has basically created you in a state where you don't know? And this is why I say to you, you need to get used to not knowing. God, it's not unloving for you to not know things. Right? God created you in that state, and as an act of love. So it's good for you to not know things and then develop a desire to know. And God actually wants you to develop a desire to know. Otherwise, he would not have created you in a state where you didn't know. Did you get that? Yeah, so it's just wonderful how God's created this process where he loves these feelings that you have where I just want to know what's going on. He wants that feeling to be developed in you by you. Yeah, and it doesn't matter to him that you don't know. He loves you when you knew nothing whatsoever. The moment of conception, just before the moment of conception, you knew nothing at all about anything, right? Except for some instinctual things, which you didn't even know about either, right? You just had it. You didn't know about it. And he created you in that state and he still loved you. So that tells me that he doesn't care how much you know. And now for most of us, as we discussed in our first group, the most of us think that what we know determines our worth. From God's perspective, you're the pinnacle of God's creation before you knew anything. So how is worth determined by what you know? It's only by pain, isn't it, that relationship has been established. It's okay to not know things. That's how God created you to be in the beginning, to not know. And then he knew you would develop desire to know, which is a part of one of the instinctual qualities he placed inside of each of us, a desire to know. Yeah. Kind of things?
So the reason that developing a relationship with God is so important is so that while we deconstruct our unloving selves, we can be re-educated in love in that process.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And in fact, deconstructing your unloving self, you see, is an essential part of the process now because we have an unloving self. But that wasn't God's intention to create an unloving self. That's what we do when we choose to do unloving things. That's what happens when we choose to sin. The unloving self gets created because of our choice to sin. Now, God knew, and we'll talk about this in a minute, that God gave us potentials. God knew that one of the potentials was your own degradation. A free will-based being must have the potential for degradation as well as the potential for growth. Isn't that not true? Otherwise, we wouldn't have free will. We wouldn't be able to decide what we wanted. Right? So God knew that you were possibly going to choose degradation. Your parents choose to not deal with their degradation. But God still created a whole heap of laws that wouldn't matter in the long run. Right? Very clever God. I keep saying that, but it's like, how can you say that enough? Like, yeah. Okay. So my created condition basically is the fact that I'm unaware, but there's an energetic pull between the two halves. But the problem is this pain that grows within me from the sin, that creates a desire to have no awareness. It creates an emotional desire within us to have no awareness. So that pushes the other half of self away from self. Well, that's the opposite thing that what God's trying. God's laws are all governing, trying to pull us together. In fact, the highest laws that God has in the universe, which actually start operating after you're at one with God, right? These laws pull you back together into a union state, into a fully, you could say, fully new soul in its embryonic state, is in the union condition. So in my mind, like 36 dimensions, you're now an embryo. Before then, you're just like cells changing, until you get to the point where in embryo you're recognizable, you know. You know, the reality is we don't recognize our true I until we get to the state where we're in a union condition with the other half. Yeah. And God designed it to be that way. It's amazing stuff. You can see that. You could ask hundreds and hundreds of questions, right? Couldn't you? It's just like, and I don't want to stop you from asking questions, but man, it's just like, I'm trying to teach you here. Like, how do I teach in 1 hour what I had to learn in 1900, it turned out to be 902 or 3 years for myself. How do I teach that in 1 hour? Pretty hard, right? So let's give up that process that's ever going to happen. And you can see that it requires also the understanding of the soul, requires the soul to develop in God's love, because there's a whole lot of things here you just will not understand at all without having God's love. And in fact, that's why the souls in a six-sphere condition are not in a union state, because there's a whole things that are incapable of understanding with their intellect. Just can't understand. The intellect is only able to cope with your understanding as the intellect grows in harmony with the soul's development. So if the soul's at a six-sphere stage, it's incapable of understanding anything above the sixth sphere until the soul develops some more emotional awareness. And then it will understand what's in the seventh sphere. So we can talk about it, but you will not understand it emotionally. Does that make sense? We can try to describe it using patterns, similes, examples, but at the end you still won't understand it until you've gone through the process, which makes sense, doesn't it? It's like you're not going to understand how to fly until you've flown, probably, or got close to that stage. I mean, levitated your own body. And you're not going to understand, obviously, the union condition until you get to the union condition. You're not going to understand its joys. You're not going to understand its power, any of those things. Does that make sense? We've got to get used to the fact that we probably don't understand much at all. Yep. Amber, you'd like to ask?
Basically, you've just clarified that basically the 7.125 billion people on the planet have no idea who they are, like at all. That's everyone right. In this room.
That's right.
No idea.
No. No. And yet God designed us to know who we are by the time we're developed intellectually at, say, age 7 or 8. Sad, eh?
Yeah.
And that's because of sin, right? And its effects. Yeah. Laura?
Because the majority of us are in the facade state,
yep.
Do you feel it's important for you to share these things with us now because it can help us with the quality?
So the real question is, why is it important to share these things with you now?
Yes.
All right, that's briefer than what you're going to do. It's important to share these things with you now because the reality is for many of you, you don't see the point of deconstructing this. You don't. You think this is you. You think this whole construction, you know, pain. And in fact, the pain believes it's, and we'll talk about this, actually probably a good time to talk about it now. It's near the end of the outline. But let's just talk about how the pain feels about the real self. The pain feels it is the real self. The pain feels it knows the truth. The pain feels that it knows that its beliefs are real, they're true. It believes in the reality of its pain, right? So this is the problem with the pain. It's got no relationship to your real self at all. Many of you believe what you currently are is because of all of these experiences you've had that have been painful. No, partly it is going to influence what you are, but in time to come, your pain will have no influence whatsoever on what you see yourself to be at all. You won't even think about it. At all. So this pain is thinking that you are somebody that you are not. So that's the state of the pain. What's the state of the facade? State of the facade is even worse, isn't it? It hates the real self because it's trying to be someone completely different. Its whole point is to be a manufactured item that you've manufactured in order to please society, please the world or whatever. That's its whole reason for existing, right? And so it's just completely rejecting your real self. So can you see we have to at least talk about what your real self is so that you get a bit of a contrast between what God's created and then what man created and what the difference is between the two things and give you some hope for the future in terms of this is what you have the potential to become and to realize and to know more about yourself with. This is what you think you are now, but a lot of it's going to disappear, and many of you are terrified of it disappearing. That's one part of your refusal of terror too. You're terrified that the person you've become now doesn't exist or won't exist. And you know what? You're right. A lot of the person you've become now will not exist in the future. And the reason why is because all of God's laws are focused at deconstructing, destroying any creation that's out of harmony with love in the universe. Now, bearing in mind that what you believe is you is mostly out of harmony with love and God's definition of what's loving in the universe, all of it, from God's perspective, is going to have to be destroyed. And most of you are just terrified of that, without knowing that there's this beautiful other part that can be developed. Can you see what's the point of that? You're going to hold on to that for dear life, right?
Yeah.
And this is what many of you are doing. You're holding on to that, like, for dear life, as if it's your life, when actually we need to keep reminding ourselves, no, we are a completely different creation with completely different potentialities. And even our what we call our personality at the moment is very much just our pain. It's not even our personality. It's just our pain.
So, because I know that you went through this material at 2014, and I kind of dismiss it completely.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
If that's predominantly fear-based, our facade and our pain, then yep. The antidote to fear is truth.
And love.
So it helps us with really seeing the truth of the full
picture. Yeah. You need to at least have a little bit of an intellectual concept, at least to see what the potentialities are, because otherwise you're going to just believe this is you. And if you believe this is you, it's sort of like we're all psychologically disturbed. And we are. From God's perspective, we're all, the whole of humanity is psychologically disturbed. The psychological disturbance is believing that their facade or their pain is the real them. That's the disturbance, right? That's why you are going to feel psychologically challenged going through this, because it is a psychological disturbance. Here is the real self, completely different. God created it. God has created a whole heap of laws for you eventually to come to terms with it and understand it. And that's going to require the use of your will too. And we're going to talk tomorrow about how you need to use your will in this regard too. You know, we've used our will unlovingly here. How can we use our will lovingly to really engage God's creation? This is the question, isn't it? To do that, we have to understand how the soul has been created, but we also have to understand the gifts that God's given to the soul to allow it to expand and grow. And that's why your next session is about God's gifts for developing your loving self. But let's move to the next section. If you look at the section in your outline, what God's creation of myself means, it's very important that you understand this section. What God's creation of myself means. For me, you know. So that's the question. Well, it means a number of things. If you look at those four main headings there, you'll see, firstly, what does it mean for your relationship with God? Well, firstly, it shows you what we've been trying to teach you for a number of years. It shows you that a relationship with God is not possible with your physical body, and it is not possible with your spirit body, because they aren't the real you. A relationship with God also is not possible if you believe this is real and you remain in that belief without deconstructing it. If you believe that, you know, this terrible creation of sin is real. And I'm not suggesting that sin is not real there. I'm just suggesting that we now believe that is the real me. And that's our big problem. It's not the case. So what does God's creation of myself mean for my soul's development in the future? It means that I cannot have a relationship with God unless that relationship with God comes from my real self. And remember, the real self is... Who's the I, the real self? Both halves. Both halves. You can, by your attitude, severely affect the development of the other half of your soul, because it's you still. It's one half of you. One way you can severely affect it is by not choosing awareness, because what that does is completely crawls rejection of the other half all the time. No matter how the other half becomes aware, you will not. And if you do refuse to go through that process, the soul is not capable of a union state, therefore not capable of development. So for many of you, you've been choosing that. You've been saying, I don't need to work through, I don't care about who my soulmate is, it's not that important to me. I'm going, what? It's not that important to you? The other half of you is not important to you, is what you just said. And I'm going, it's one of the most important things you're going to have to deal with in your life, because it's a part of who the I is. It does matter. You've got to develop it. You've got to develop your awareness of it at some point. At some point, you've got to choose that. Right? And why do we do that? It's because quite often we're living in relationships. Sorry, just flip my mic. Living in relationships where we're like wanting that relationship so desperately because it fulfills so many of our addictions, that we're completely unwilling to examine the fact that actually one of the most important things we can do is come to know who is the other half of ourselves and what the other half of ourselves is feeling, experiencing, and what we can do to stop blocking the other half from becoming aware of us. Right? Very important processes. So that's number one. A whole self has a relationship with God. Two halves are going to can become at one with God, but they can never enter a complete relationship with God through to the point of the union state. And God designed you to be in the union state. That's the design of the soul. God designed that. Whenever you prevent anything God designs, you're naturally going to be restricting your own happiness. Everything God designed is beautiful and happy, and everything we do, even through restriction, is limiting our happiness. Even, we might not be terribly unhappy, but we're not going to be in the state that God designed us to be, ever, if we continue doing it. Graham, you'd like to ask?
If we're wrong about who we think our soulmate is, can that have a bad effect on our progress?
Well, not if you have an attitude of deconstructing your facade and deconstructing your terror and deconstructing your false beliefs, no. Because as you deconstruct all of that, you'll recognise that you were wrong and you will accept that.
So how is that different from not really caring too much about whether you've got with your soulmate or not?
Well, not caring means you're in total denial. You have no desire at all to resolve the issue. So one is a state of complete denial of the other half of self. The other is a state of at least accepting a part of the fact that you have another half, even though you're thinking it's the wrong person. You've at least being open to the concept emotionally that you have another half, and you're willing to address the issue emotionally. Right, so that tells me there's a growing awareness that there is another half. Right, if you examine most children by the time they reach teenage years, they want to pair up. Right, it's not just addiction that causes that process. It's a part of recognizing another half. As adults, we go through relationship after relationship that are unsatisfactory, and then we get to the point where we're really in a lot of denial about our relationships, and we're trying to reject the fact that a relationship is very, very important to the happiness in our life. And when we're in a state of complete rejection, complete denial, that's a worse state than it is to be partially aware. Does that make sense, Graham? You're not happy with that answer? That's all right.
No,
we can
really.
Move. We can move on. Mary, would you like to say?
It's a question.
Yep.
I'm being open to spirit questions today.
No worries.
Yep. It's a three-parter almost,
yeah.
So I'll be quick. Do I have to deconstruct all facade and release all pain before I develop my real self?
Well, no, you don't. You can begin development of your real self when you're in the hells. So you can start the development of your real self, but to do that, you're going to have to eventually address this stuff here that you've created, aren't you? Because this is going to limit how much you'll accept of your real self. So you can be in the worst possible condition and start developing your real self, but the problem with that generally is most people don't do it because they've got a whole heap of blocks here to their real self. Mm-hmm. So the potential exists, but in reality, you're probably going to have to deconstruct a fair portion of that to start accepting particularly the other half of self, but also develop yourself. And in fact, unless you deal with that, you're probably not going to even recognize your real self and understand what it is.
Yeah, I think that answered the quiz. The second part was, do I have to do all that to develop an awareness of who my soulmate is?
Well, you won't have to do all that, but you'll have to do the majority of that. And this is why the majority of people are not knowing who their soulmate is in the spirit state until they're in the fifth sphere of the spirit world, because they've done the majority of that. Mm-hmm. And they've gotten rid of a lot, particularly a lot of their intergender emotional addictions, which are the primary problem that controls our awareness of our other half, and you have to, you know, release that. Of course, in our spirit state, it's easy to recognize the other half because it's just a matter of following the rose-colored cord that comes out of oneself and leads to the other half, that rose-colored cord being the actual energetic stream that connects the two halves together. So the reality is a person in the hell can recognize the rose-colored cord coming out of them towards the other half and follow that cord, and where it leads is the other half.
And if I can,
but that doesn't stop them from being completely unaware. Yeah. Does it?
And if I can't see the cord?
If you can't see the cord, then you've not allowed the emotion of love to exist within yourself at all. Okay. So the emotion of love is not what's driving you anymore. If there's no cord in the spirit state coming out of the person, a rose-colored cord coming out of the person, connecting them to another person, that they can't see it, it means that they're emotionally numb to the emotion of love of another person on a sexual level, an emotional level. Hmm. And the majority who are here are in that state. You're emotionally numb to real love. So most relationships on earth are driven totally by addiction. What you've got cords going back and forward between the other half and yourself, but not towards the other half, but, you know, the person you're living with. You've got cords going back and forward, but most of those cords going back and forward are demands, beliefs of that are out of harmony with love, things where codependent bartering systems and so forth. They've got nothing to do with love. And therefore, when you pass in the spirit world into that in that state, you won't even recognize the dullness of the rose-colored cord would be so dull that you won't even be able to see it. It still exists. A spirit who's in a higher condition can see it. And that's how they find the other half, if you can't find them. But you won't see it. Mm. Make sense? Make sense to them, babe?
Yes. We could have a whole conversation here. So if someone I'm with now, just following on from what you've said, is assisting me to live in denial, then that's keeping me away.
Yes.
From this awareness.
Yes, and this is why codependent addictions are so damaging to the development of the soul. Yeah. Most of you engage codependent addictions in relationship frequently, if not all the time, and that is completely like against any soul development. And you don't realize the importance of that. So when I talk about a codependent addiction, your alarm bells are not going ding, 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 I've got to work on this. It's going, oh yeah, it's just another thing I've got to work on. And you don't think of it, right, even. And yet it's one of the primary things you're going to have to address, even to connect to who I am. It's one of the primary things you would need to address. Okay, so next thing, my relationship with myself. What does it mean for my relationship with myself? Well, the more emotionally unaware I am of my creation and how I've been created, the more emotionally unaware I am, and I'm already 4 minutes over. All right. The more emotionally unaware I am, I am going to create what's called a separation of myself from my other half. So I'll never experience myself unless I, at some point, open up to the other half of myself. You're just experiencing a half of yourself, and to be frank with you, you're experiencing much less than that. Because the one of the things that God's created is a cycling or a circulation of emotional energy between the halves. So the more you shut down that expression, the more unaware you become. Does that make sense? Of yourself, of who you are. You need the other half of yourself to understand who you are. Make sense? And I need to just plow through some of these things. My relationship with the universe is severely affected if I don't understand. The reason why, or don't engage the development, the reason why is because the universe was created as a playground for the whole soul. There's a whole heap of things that you cannot play with if you don't enter that place of being a whole soul. You have a limited playground. So it's a bit like saying, you know, do you want to go to Dreamworld here on the Gold Coast, or do you want to just play in the playground behind me here, you know, where there's a few swings and a slippery dip? What would you like to do? Most of us are choosing the few swings and the slippery dip and going, well, it's a pretty boring playground God's created for me. And not understanding that, you know, the whole, you know, the four-part paths down in the Gold Coast where we've got, what is it, Dreamworld and Wet n' Wild and all the others. That's like our playground, but what we're thinking is that it's like this single, you know, slippery dip and a few swings. We're severely limiting our experience of the universal playground if we do not develop our soul, our whole soul. So that's a very important thing to understand, isn't it? You see? It has a big effect on us in terms of our enjoyment and our happiness. Yeah. And the last thing, of course, is that for the sake of my own development, I can't develop any further than the sixth dimension of the spirit world unless I have started to allow this process of awareness of the soul union to develop. And in fact, that's a part of the seventh sphere transition, in fact. So a person is going to really, really struggle to get to the seventh sphere of the spirit world unless they've received enough of God's love to start to understand the awareness of the other half of itself and how that interplays upon itself and so forth. And allowing the flow of emotional energy between the two halves. And I keep on saying emotional energy because I want you to understand that this is a soul-based feeling rather than just a thought. It's not thoughts here that we're talking about. Everything that connects the two halves of the soul is feeling-based, emotionally based. Without it, you can't have a connection with the other half. That's why in the sixth sphere, there's plenty that are, you know, partially connected, you know, living in that completed state from a perfect natural man perspective, but they have no idea of what could be experienced in the union state. Oh, and no idea or even concept that it's even possible. They have no idea actually of the soul itself. They have not yet discovered their real selves, right? They've experienced a lot of their real self because they've developed a lot of desires and passions that are now a part of their real self, but they haven't discovered it in terms of an actual awareness-based knowledge. It's just an experiential knowledge. It's sort of like a child, you know, going outside and playing. A lot of times it's just experiencing things, but it doesn't have a cognizant awareness of what it's experiencing. And that's what many six-sphere spirits who are together with their other halves are experiencing in their soul state. They have not got a cognizant awareness, because a cognizant awareness means that you must have received God's love in order to understand, and you must be connected emotionally in order to understand, and that's not happening. So for your own sake at least start, you know, seeing what is there. At least start becoming aware of what is there. At least allow the process of awareness to develop, to see where you're shutting down and separating emotionally from the other half of self. Now, of course, you can see that deconstructing this creation of sin is going to substantially assist in the developing of the awareness of this. You can see that, can't you? So obviously the more you deconstruct here, the more you'll start becoming aware of what's going on here. And in fact, it's a process that God designed, that as people progress through the spheres up until the eighth, that is the process where you're becoming increasingly aware of what the soul really is. You start to gain a soul-based feeling of what it really is through that process. And you start, and because you've released blockages that reject the other half of yourself from yourself, you're starting to feel the connection with the other half. And in fact, for many, that they can feel who it is, they know who it is, even if, no matter what condition is, they might be in the hell stool or whatever, they can feel who it is, they feel the emotions of that person, they can feel the feelings of that person, they know what they think. And eventually when you get into union state, it's not, you don't even have a separate thought and you don't have a separate feeling. The two halves don't have separate thoughts or separate feelings. You are in fact one being. Does that make sense? That has the same thoughts, same feelings, same desires, same passions, same personality. Yeah. Remarkable creation. Yeah. One of the most, it is the most complex creation in God's universe. All right, well, let's have a 10-minute break. If we can come back at 10 to 1, and we'll do a Q&A on that.